Hello gamers, Pat here, welcome to my Crusader Kings 3 review and tutorial. I've waited a little bit on making the video because I wanted to see what are the questions that the players who want to try this game have, what they don't understand. So hopefully my tutorial is going to be better than the one I've done 7 years ago for Crusader Kings 2, which, by the way, check this out. Hello gamers, this is Pat from GamerPat.com and welcome to my Crusader Kingdom for 2-3 hours.
This is me in 7 July 2013 making a review and tutorial about Crusader Kings 2. A tutorial that, when it comes to the view numbers, it's low compared to YouTube in general, but it's very good for me and also a pretty good impact with people who left me a couple of good comments asking, you know, about the game and telling me that I'm like the guy from Despicable Me, which seems to be like a thing that I get a lot in my videos. So I guess that's something, right? Anyway, in this tutorial, I want to improve upon the tutorial that I've done 7 years ago. And this is kind of the, if this is the first time you see my tutorials, I'm trying to look on how to explain the game on a human level to allow you to understand, to start to play the game, and you, for you to explore the game by yourself, trying out new things, you know, to give you enough for you to get started. That's the goal, at least. Hopefully I will succeed, right? Now, in case, since I'm also making this as a review, if you want to hear my opinion, great game. Even that Crusader Kings 2 right now is complete because it has a lot of DLCs. Crusader Kings 3 has a lot of new things to bring to the table, which makes the game really, really well. And I won't go back on playing Crusader Kings 2, only maybe in 10 years for nostalgia purposes, but right now Crusader Kings 3 has enough to keep you entertained for hours, and it has a couple of new cool things that brings to the table. And also, if this is if you were never able to get into Crusader Kings 2, I think Crusader Kings 3 does a much better job to help the players get in. The game is not like super simplified, like it's very easy, and if you're a hardcore player, you're not going to enjoy the game anymore, but it's a couple of concepts are a little bit easier to understand. However, I still think that the most difficult thing to comprehend is this whole feudal system on how you inherit titles. What's a duchy, what's a barony, what's a county, what's a kingdom, and so on. And this is the aspects that made the game a little bit confusing, and hopefully I will be able to help you out. So let's actually go in inside the game and just go on, you know, hitting new game, and then I will try to tell you a little bit more about this map. Basically, you can play with any character, almost any character, with some exceptions. For example, you can't play baronies. You can't play baronies. I know you don't know what that is. It's no problem. But you can play with any duchy and from above, basically. And I will show you the map in a second, but basically the game suggests two start dates, 867 and 1066. There are some, those are some really good good starting dates, and the game actually provides you with a couple of good suggestions on who to start, and if you select them, you will be able to read more, some info about them, because again, it's a game about the character, it's a game about the dynasty, and you know, the game, officially, it's a grand strategy game, but people have been calling it an RPG game. People have been calling it kind of a game, kind of like The Sims. And in some cases, it's actually true. It's also the reason why I love this game, because you don't control everything in this game, but you can influence on how you control the game, which is great because things happen and you are trying to keep your best, and you are playing a leader, you're the ruler that's currently right now, but when that ruler dies, if you have an heir, and you're supposed to have one, you're going to play as that heir. And basically it's not a game about yourself as the ruler that you are playing right now, but it's a game about your dynasty, and the purpose is, you know, like your family, basically. And the purpose is to spread your family around the globe, trying to have people with territory and so on, because that will going to give you points and going to make you an interesting game, right? And I will go into detail a little bit later with some things that you can do. And also at the end, I will have kind of like a checklist of stuff that you can do when you start the game. So that way you won't feel overwhelmed, because this is a game that doesn't have like a clear goal for you. You are making your own goal. So, which is also what makes this a little bit challenging for some people. So let's actually click play as any ruler. And then I will show you the map and go into more details. So again, it's focused on the early Middle Ages. This is the whole map that you can play right now. It has Africa, which is something very, very exciting for me, because I want to explore that area. It has India. It has Europe, of course, the northern parts, and then England and Scotland and even Iceland. So yeah, there is a lot of things for you to explore. So for example, at this level, if I'm clicking, for example, France, the whole France gets selected, and I will play as King Philippe of France. I'm playing at the highest level, right? But let's look at the lowest, which is Dutch titles. As you can see, everything is split into duchies. Like for example, the duchy of, it's a little bit hard to, I will try to start the game and, let's actually start the game with on my town, which is I already have a games that I've started there, and it started to be really, really exciting. So yeah, that's going to be interesting. Now, the thing with this game, which is the reason why I like it a lot, is that it's a game that generates stories. I still remember a game that I had in Crusader Kings 2 where I was playing in Ireland. This is called the tutorial island, basically. And in Crusader Kings 3, when you start the tutorial, you are going to actually start here. And I think you are starting in Leinster with those two territories, I believe. And the thing is, with the reason why this is a good start location is that you don't get, you know, invaded by too many things. You are kind of separated, and you are mostly playing the politics of the island itself, right? So I had this queen, my main ruler died, and a queen who at then was 3 years old came to power, and then it was a total mess, and I was like, oh my god, how am I going to fix this? But then that queen lived for something like 80 something years, and it had prosperous, everything started to go well, and I still remember that game. And the second game that I already have a video on Crusader Kings 3, I have a video with a character that also lived for 83 years, and it was very enjoyable, and the dynasty started to have a lot of skills and a lot of perks, and I made a video about that. You can find it on my channel. So yeah, it's a game that generates stories, and it's great because you never don't know exactly what's going to happen. You try to fiddle with things, and then things happen. And anyway, it's great. I'm going to repeat myself saying that the game is great, but hopefully it's not going to get too annoying. So the game, as I've said, has a much better tutorial right now. It has a wiki, but let's actually start the game. I'm going to start to play with Count Benny, which is this guy. You can start as Iron Man, which means that you're only going to have one save file and you can't do save scumming. If you're from the beginning, don't recommend on doing Iron Man, because if you want to experiment and the experiment fails, Iron Man will punish you, and you might not know how to recover. Maybe, you know, start a new game and so on. But when Iron Man is enabled, achievements are enabled. But, you know, that's something for later for you. And then you can also customize all of the rules. Not going to focus on that. And you also have difficulty right now. Very easy, easy, normal. And that's about it. I'm playing it on normal. I think it's nice to experiment. Yeah. So let's start the game. As you can see, the game already started. This is me. This is a duchy. And the duchy is split into three baronies. As you can see, those are three things when I'm hovering over. You can't play as a baron. That's fine. Duchy is the guy that has baronies under him. This is going to be really challenging to explain. Hopefully I'm going to make sense of it. But take it like this. This is me, and I have this territory. The guys that are having the baronies are my vassals, but me myself, I'm the vassal of my liege, right? King Salmon of Hungary has me as a vassal. I'm not an independent ruler. One of the goals that you might want to do is to become an independent ruler, because that means more money, more prestige, and so on, right? So going back on what the game is doing better on in order to teach you, you have an open an encyclopedia where you can read a lot about the game and tough stuff here. Don't worry about it. The reason why I'm showing it to you is because it's nice to find things fast if you're curious about something and you want to read about something. But as you can see, there is a tooltip that kind of pops up. So, for example, you are not sure what's the deal with the coin. You are clicking the mouse over and it's going to tell you exactly where the coin is coming from. For example, this is the prestige. I have 450. I'm level of fame. You don't know, or better, you don't know what the prestige is. Just mouse over prestige and it's going to tell you what prestige is. And then you don't know what doctrine is, you mouse over doctrines and it's going to tell you what doctrine is. You don't know what fate is, you are going to mouse over and it's going to tell you what fate is. You don't know what religion is, you're going to mouse over and it's going to tell you what religion is. And so on. It's very easy to find information right now. Even if it's not making sense from the start, it's okay because it's there. And later, again, you don't have to memorize everything because everything is there at the tooltip. So this is kind of like a cool concept. What's dread? Right, you mouse over, oh, dread is the measure on how feared a ruler is, okay, and so on, right? So, for example, what's a county? A county is a title ranking below a duchy and above barony. I kind of mentioned those things already, right? What's a barony? Baronies are the lowest ranked titles and have the smallest footprint on the map organized into larger counties, right? So anyway, what's a duchy? A duchy is a title ranking below a kingdom and above the county. Holder of a duchy, the jure right, and so on. Anyway, the tooltip is something that's great and is going to allow you to learn a lot about the game. Now, the game is mostly focusing around characters. The characters are the key in the whole game. Like, for example, if you played any RPG games, maybe in general, if you play board games or if you play Europa Universalis 4, at some point you will have an army, let's say, that's on this territory, and then you mouse over and you seem to conquer a lot of territories, and then the war ends, you win, but you only gain one county, and you'll be like, huh, what's that about? That's because of the claims and how the feudal system works. Again, mentioning that feudal system, which is going to be I like it because it's history, it's allowing me to learn more about history in general, and I like history. So going back on the characters, one, this is a character, this is my ruli. I'm Count Benny of Temes. It's and Temesvar is the county Timișoara where I'm currently located, and I'm 27 years old. The health is fine. I'm heterosexual. And I'm greedy, which has some modifications to stats and so on. I'm arbitrary, the same thing. Forgiving, again, since things happen. By the way, you saw how the tooltip disappeared. If you want to do that thing where you mouse over more things, when I'm hovering over a tooltip, you see there is an animation that goes up, and then when that goes up, the tooltip becomes a little bit hardened with a harder border. Now I can move over of other things. See, the same thing. Boof. And now I can move over. Just keep that in mind. And you can customize this. It's not a problem. And I'm a fortunate builder, which gives me stewardship plus 6. You don't know what stewardship is? Again. Now, you can mouse over. So, one of the new things that's on Crusader Kings 3, they kind of introduced this in Crusader Kings 2. You basically have right now a focus tree. As you can see, it's telling me that no lifestyle chosen. You have no lifestyle. What's a lifestyle? Well, I'm going to mouse over and it's going to tell me what the lifestyle is. But basically, one cool thing in Crusader Kings 3 is that you have those 5 distinct paths, like diplomacy, martial, stewardship, intrigue, and learning. Right now it says that I receive more experience under stewardship, and that's mostly because my character is a fortunate builder, which is an education trait that focuses on stewardship. And if I'm going to click here, I'm going to have three different trees. And whenever I'm getting experience to random events or just by, you know, I'm getting 32 per month, I'm going to be able to put some points into one of those thingies that is going to give me, for example, Taxman is giving me collecting taxes effectiveness to plus 25%. This is going to allow me to build buildings much faster and so on. And there is an entire debate on what's good, what trees are good, what trees are not good and so on. Don't worry about that. The reason why I'm showing this to you is because it's a really nice way on you to allow to experiment with the game, to try out different things and so on. So for example, Intrigue has a tree that allows you to focus on torture stuff. And it's going to, you know, it's, you can torture people, but this is going to lower the opinion on other vassals and other people around you, and you don't want that. But if you have, for example, divine retribution, you do not lose piety or clergy opinion from torturing and executing others. What? Anyway, this is going to be great to experiment, see how things go, and it's a new thing in Crusader Kings 3. Now, let's actually go speak a little bit about those skills. This is diplomacy, this is martial, stewardship, intrigue, and learning. Not going to go into too many details, but basically diplomacy allows you to, it's the character ability to charm, negotiate, and pursue, which means that the higher diplomacy you have, the more good opinion people are going to have about you. Because as you can see, this is my spouse, and she has an opinion of me of plus 38. And this is telling me why. This is telling me like personal diplomacy is minus 4. This is my heir, it's my daughter, plus 71. Let's actually look real fast. Someone who hates me. I mean, minus 22 on this guy. Why? Short reign, because I've just started. Generous, he's generous, I'm greedy, it's not matching up. Minus 15. And so, and it's going to be important because you want to please people, important people, and you know, like in general, like in real life, it's a human term, it's an RPG game after all, right? So this is what diplomacy is going to do. Martial, it's mostly related to combat stuff, like army fighting and so on. Stewardship, it's going to allow you to have a deeper, a bigger domain, to allow the ability to get taxes better and so on. Intrigue involves scheming, you know, intrigue in general, finding secrets about other people. And learning, it's, let's actually see how it's going to define the Ryan. Learning is a skill measure on character, literacy and wisdom. In the past it used to be a little bit related to charge, so this is why I was a little bit confused, but anyway. Don't worry too much about those, but those are the keys, the key to rules in general. You want to have kids that have a high rating and so on, right? Another skill is, for example, this prowess, which is your personal hand-to-combat skill, like a guy who is keeping a sword and you are going to cut things on the field. It's important for some people, and I will tell those to you later. Now, one thing that's very, very important in Crusader Kings 3 when it comes to your dynasty and so on are congenital traits. Let me actually look for someone. Going to click find a character. Those are characters that are in the game right now. As you can see, they have skills, they have their culture, they have their religion, they have claims on titles that can claim or and so other stuff, they have their opinion on you and so on. But if I'm going to put, for example, I should be able to for example, genius is a trait, and there are no geniuses characters yet, or at least no to me. But for example, let's quick is something. Okay, this guy is, for example, quick. Quick is a congenital trait, for example. This congenital trait gives him plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, and monthly lifestyle experience plus 10%. And congenital traits, basically, are traits that can be inherited by your children. So, for example, if you have this trait, your children have a percentage of inheriting that trait. If your spouse also has the same trait, there is a higher chance for that kid to have that trait. And going down the line, you want to have your dynasty have these positive traits, because it will allow your dynasty to become better and better. For example, quick is the lowest of this type of physical trait, and it's going in giving you plus one, but there is genius who have plus five of all the ability, and that's a lot, right? There are also negative, let's actually go to for example, dwarf. Can I see it? Or maybe I can't see it. That's not how you write it. Cognital, yeah, I have problems with that. So cognital are traits. For example, intelligent is plus three, and then there is also genius. And I wanted to show you actually dwarf. Do we get some character that has I want a negative. For example, dwarf. Oh, I can just do it like this. So for example, dwarf, it's, you know, like a short guy. Prowess, it's much smaller, he fights lowest, he fights lowest, yes, and so on. So those traits are pretty important, and also it's very important when you are going to marry to other characters. Right now I'm married, basically, but let's actually try to find for my daughter. I can arrange a marriage for her, and I can only, never mind. It's a bit unfortunate because this character is already married. It would be cool to show you, but I will find to show it with some other people. Anyway, so as I've said, this kind of covers the skills which are important, and the personality traits, and then the education trait. This is something that you gain when the child grows up based on the education he received between 0 and 16 when he's an adult. Then you also have those. The culture, the fate, as I've said, and then other details about this about myself. But then again, you can click anyone, and then you are going to see their skills, their perks, and so on. And those are important because you want to have good people on your court, around you. You will see immediately why. Now, the most important thing about this game, as I've said, is the dynasty, which can be found over here. If you click this one, as you can see, it is House Gutkalf. I'm not sure how to pronounce it. It has a blazon. I forgot how is this called in English. The herald, something like that. It's founded in this year by this guy. Right now it's dead. This is the dynasty head, which is my uncle. Our reputation is obscure because we are not known. The next level is insignificant. Then it's noteworthy, then it's reputable, then it's well known, then it's significant, then it's famous, then it's glorious, and so on. And again, this is kind of like the purpose. It's trying to rise the renown of both. And you can see it over here. And if you move over, you can see that I'm getting 0.92 renown per month. And that's because of the 11 living members, 2 counts, 1 count by marriage. So as you can see, it's important to have a bigger family, which who have titles, who are married into kings and so on, right? Now, you might say, what happens with this renown? A new thing in Crusader Kings 3, you have dynasty legacies. And basically, when you open the legacies, you have kind of like things to unlock. So, for example, you have Warfare, Rao, Guile, Blood, Erudition, Glory, and Kin. For example, you know, I've speaked about the congenital traits. Look at Blood. Careful breeding to produce the most worthy successors. First thing is noble veins. Chance of inheriting good congenital traits per 30%. Chance of new good congenital traits plus 30%. Second, change of reinforcing congenital trait plus 30%, and then at the end, life expectancy plus 5 years, which means that our people, right, everybody in the dynasty, not only the guy that you are playing, everybody in the dynasty will have a higher life expectancy, which means that live more, which means more points, right? So anyway, not going to go on all those trees, but this is something cool that you can do, and you can explore to see how to play the game different. Now, it says we have 13 members. Let's see the dynasty tree. As you can see, this is the dynasty tree, which is pretty low. This was my grandfather, who had 2 sons, my father and my uncle, who's still alive. My father had three children, my half-brother, my half-brother and myself. And myself, I have a daughter, which is Gertrude. Then we also have this cousin and so on, right? And you can click on them. As you can see, they are on my dynasty and then have their own skills and they have their own thingies. It's not that exciting right now. I mean, this guy, my uncle, actually has territory. I can see it because he has the county of Bucks. He has two titles. So he's right now the dynasty head because he has more land than me. This is something important when it comes to the dynasty head. It's house head. Every house with a dynasty has a house head who wields certain unique powers over the members of the house. You want that to be you. Anyway, moving on. Another thing, new thing is the religion. Right now we are on the Catholicism, which is my faith. We have tenets, things that we can do, we can't do. We have sins, we have virtues, we have the doctrines, we have marriage doctrines, we have crime doctrines, we have clergy draw things. This is the Pope, the head, which is the Pope actually. We have holy sites, and if our religion, right, I'm of this religion, if other king or whatever with my that religion holds one of those holy sites, we all get those to all the Christians, to all the Catholics, get those thingies, those perks, those traits, right? The thing is that you can create a new Christian faith that's going to split from this one. You can choose the name, you can choose the tenets, and it's going to cost you points, and so on. And you can then customize the religion itself to change the sins, to change the virtues, but of course it's going to cost you a lot of piety. Piety, it's a currency that you gain depending doing pious things, like going on a pilgrimage and so on. I know it's a bit confusing because you don't know what going on a pilgrimage means. Soon we will get them there. Anyway, so this is something new in Crusader Kings 2. Then we also have the culture. The culture, we are part of the Magyar group. The culture head is of course the King of Hungary, because that's the guy who is in this culture group, and he has the most territory. Ideally, you want that to be you. Everything is about power and having territory. Now, the thing that's a little bit changed from Crusader Kings 2, as you can see. At first, on those years, we start as tribal, where we have different things to unlock, different civics, different military. For example, in those periods of time, we develop modes, we develop currency, and so on. Right now we are here. We are still, for example, don't have royal prerogative, which is something that our culture group does not have. Other culture groups maybe have. This is kind of like how the culture moves around. And usually culture improves very, very slowly, right? But the guy who's the culture cat can select a focus. And right now the culture head is Prince Laszlo, and he's focusing on the battlements, meaning that battlements is going to research a little bit faster. Nothing to worry about that much, but yeah. Another new thing in the game is stress that you can see here. It's three levels of stress. When you reach the third level, you die. And this is kind of like a new cool thing to allow you to manage the game better, because with stress, there will be events that become stressful. And they are kind of cool. I will talk more about random events. Those are things that pop up and it tells you that this happened, and then you take some decision, you have some buttons, you will see that. The thing is that the character, for example, my character is greedy, right? But if an event that tells me that I need to spend money, and since I'm greedy, I'm going to gain some stress, because it is that choice that I'm the human pet, me, hi, is going to choose goes over the character in the game that's straight. Like, I this guy is greedy, but me in real life, I'm not that greedy, right? So it's interesting on how it makes you RPG the character that you are playing, right? So yeah, that's interesting new mechanic. And yeah, I've already talked about the character opinion, but this is something that you will want to keep higher up. Like, for example, let's say that I want to rise the character of my wife to various reasons, I can right click on everything. I can right click on characters, on things that I can interact with, and I can, for example, sway, which is a personal. I can do diplomacy with her. I can do hostile stuff like murder, and it's going to start the murder scheme. But I can also sway her, and it's going to attempt to sway Countess Amalia, improving her opinion of you. And when I click this, it's going to tell me the percentage, the chance that I have to do that, and how long it's going to take. For the fun of it, let's start. And as you can see, I've started to do that. It also appeared here, and it also appeared over here, when I can need more details about it. Let's move forward. Territory, which is the most important thing when it comes to that time of period, right? Because the territory is what you want to have. It brings, it's going to bring you power, you know, prestige. It's going to give you titles. It's going to have vassals under you. It's going to give you army and so on. Right now, my army is 155 because I only have this county. It's small. But for example, if I am to start fighting the King of Hungary, this guy has a huge territory. Even that him himself doesn't own all of this territory. Like, for example, I'm under himself. I'm myself sending him a percentage of the money I make and the percentage of the people I have. The same thing happens to me, since I have people under me. If I'm going to click here on the realm, as you can see, I have one vassal, which is Meyer Martin of Lugos. This is actually Lugos. This is the guy that holds this city, right? He's the mayor of that city. He's a republic, so he's kind of like a different, and I don't going to go into details. But for example, he's paying me 0.4 gold per month, and he's sending 12 guys to me. Yeah, 10% of 122, right? Like, and also Temesh, which is the main thing that I'm holding right now, I'm having 2.9 gold because it's my territory, which is why I want to have the maximum of domain. I have 1 out of 5. I can only have 5 titles, 5 territory of my own self because of the stewardship skill that I'm currently having. If this number will be higher, I can have 6 and so on. What happens when I'm going over the number? Let's say that I'm having 6 out of 5. People are going to be upset with me because I'm not giving out, I'm keeping too much to myself. On a human level, they are upset at me, which is why I want to give that territory to other people. For example, someone in your own dynasty, but that guy will become your vassal. He's still kind of your territory, but you don't hold the title. Oh, and this is going to be a little bit hard to explain, but don't worry about it. So for example, this is County of Temesh, right? Which has City of Lugos and Bishopric of blah, blah, blah. This is de jure part of Duchy of Temes, right? This is county. The higher territory is the duchy. And if I'm hovering over this, this is the duchy. The duchy has those territories. County of Arad, County of Ksad, County of Kras. Those things. And inside my realm, it's telling me, in County of Temesh, it's telling me that it's inside my realm because I'm having those. I don't have those. So if I want to get my hands on the Duchy of Temesh and kind of go a little bit above, I should try to get my hands on... I believe I need something like 60% of, or 50 something percent of the county. So if I get 2 more, I will have a total of 3 versus... two, and I will be able to press my claims on the Duchy of Temesh. The thing with this is that this is kind of like de jure. De jure means so weird to explain. It's kind of like the law when you, I think it's also saying it there, most titles are considered part of a higher level title, de jure. By law, that means, de jure means by law. By law, the Duchy of Temesh has those territories. Me, myself, as a character, by law, I only have rights to County of Temesh. So for me, in order to, for example, get my hands on this, for example, this, let's actually go back, Temesh. Let's go to County of Arad, which is this one, which is actually owned by Prince Lazo of Hungary, and then those guys are in line to inherit the County of Arad. If I want to have some claims on that territory, I can go and to my council and they'll tell my my bishop to fabricate claims on Arad. Because right now, if I am to go to Prince Laszlo and tell him to declare a war, I can't declare a war on other characters if I don't have a true reason, a true legal reason, right? He is from my own religion, so I can't declare a holy war, for example, and so on. And that's the reason, because I don't have a casus belli, which means cause for war, a reason to declare war, as I've said. This is one of the reasons why people start with Ireland, is because when you start, I believe, with Monster, as you can see, this is a good example. He has those two territory. He has these titles. He has the title of Earldom of Tomod, basically that thing that lights up, right? But he's also having the title of Petty Kingdom of Munster and an unclaimed title to unpressed claim to Kingdom of Ireland. So this guy is pretty badass, right? But because he has this claim on Petty Kingdom of Munster, however you say it, it means that he can declare war on this guy. Because this Earldom of Desmond, it's under the Petty Kingdom of Munster. And this guy, de jure, he has that title. It means that, hey, that's mine by the paper, it's mine. So he will be able to declare war because he has a de jure claim on him. And he will be able to conquer the territory. And of course, now this guy will also have this title, the Earldom of Desmond, right? Hopefully it's better. I still... You will get it. You will get it, and even if you don't get it, you will get it a little bit, and then some other parts will be a little bit more confusing. Yet don't worry about it. It's going to be enough for you to start to play the game. So this is kind of how you get your territory. And now I'm going to go back to main menu, and I'm going to start with load with. It's this is the same guy that I've just showed you, but I play with him a good couple of years, because right now look, I started in Temesh, right? But now I have this territory, and I've also created the Duchy of Transylvania Alps, which again renamed the country. And my scope is to kind of get this territory, which is Romania, and I wanted to try to create Valachia and so on. As you can see, Kingdom of Valachia. In order for me to do that, I already have the Duchy of Transylvania, but then I need the Duchy of Muntenia, which is this part, and the Duchy of Oltenia, which is this part. And I already have two of them. The County of Severin, I don't. And you know, it's telling me, which is critical, I can't create the title because I only have two of the three required counties and I don't have the gold, and it will give me prestige if I do that. So this is something that I'm going to aim for. I've been fighting with the Pechinegi, not sure how it's called in English, Pechinegi, and so on. It's a little bit annoying because this territory is now part of the Byzantine Empire and they are a lot. Right now, I'm also a little bit protected since I'm not independent ruler. If someone wants to declare war on me, they will declare war on Hungary, which is pretty big right now. And at some point, I want to try out to become independent, of course. So right now, Calafat is independent. What the hell? This guy is totally independent. He's 11 years old. And no heir, no nothing. I can declare war.
Yay.
I can declare a holy war on him. I don't. He's on a different religion, and Catholicism allows you to declare holy wars. And it's telling me that he has an inferior army. It's going to cost me this much piety. I would go for a war for the duchy to give me the... If I win this war, I will get the county of Calafat. If I go like this, I will get the duchy of Oltenia. In a way, it's... I'm not sure if it's going to... What's going to happen? Because some territory out of the duchy of Oltenia, I already own. So I might not... I might have... But the thing is that I can't. I don't have enough piety right now. But the thing is that I will be able to declare the war, and he has no one, and I will actually do that right now for the fun of it, to show you some parts of on how to get this territory, right? So I'm going to declare war. He has an ally, which is this guy, who also hates me, by the way. His army is not that big, and hopefully I will be able to conquer him pretty fast. So I'm going to declare war again. I have army right now because I've improved stuff. Declaring war. I'm going to select this rally point, and I'm going to click rise all army here, because I don't need them there. I'm going to wait a little bit so the army it's there, and now I'm going to right click again where the capital is, and I'm going to siege that territory. Now, things are going to pop up, things are going to happen. I'm going to wait to reach that area. I'm going to pause the game. Again, the game is, you can start, pause at any time. This is the speed right now. I'm usually playing on speed 5, you know, which is said it's not fastest, right? And whenever something, a fast decision that I need to take, I'm pausing the game. And then I'm looking, and then I'm resuming. What should I speak of? Let's actually conquer this. Some things will pop up, and then I will go into some of the important things. If I'm going to click the siege right now, you can see something happening. It might take 6 months. I have daily siege progress. I have a much more bigger army than him. I can't assault the fort yet because the walls have not been breached. He has a fort level of 3, which means that he has bastions and curtain walls. So he has kind of like a castle there, right? And then every some days it's going to normal. It's going to happen some random event. It's going to bring the siege down, right? And now this is a random event that I wanted to talk about. Lessons from the past. True, I will surely see many battlefields before I meet my maker. My library holds tales from war from 100 lifetimes. I have recently acquired a tome of Great Siege of Constantinople, as well as time-worn scroll written in some ancient language. Who knows what forgotten secret holds? It's focusing me. Read the new tome. And if I'm mousing over, you gain studied old battle for 10 years, which will give me parse plus one marshal for 10 years. Then I will translate to the old scroll, and it's a learning challenge. I'm having 50% I uncover a piece of ancient knowledge, and 50% I will fail to decipher the scroll. I think I will try to do this, even if it's 50-50%, but that one marshal is not helping me that much. But those other things will happen. And I'm clicking it. Okay, the event continued. Even with the help of Deusti Glossary, the scroll is eluted and said it's secret, but I press on. As the night progresses, the most incredible story unfolds before me. The scroll describes the Battle of Gaxia, the Han commander, and so on and so on. Study the battle, and it's going to give me studied Battle of Galaxia. You see, more stuff. I mean, I basically succeeded the other thingy. And martial experience. On focus on the translation process, and it's going to be learning plus two and martial experience. I think this one it's much better for me because it's giving me martial and learning and enemy fighter classes and so on. So for 20 years, so I will do that. And another event, spouse, tourney day, the sun is shining and peasants are milling about the tourney hosted by my wife. All my knights cheer as Duchess announces the tournament in their honor, and for once I get a simplicity to watch. I'm not going to spend... So basically every knight gains plus 20 opinion of you for 8 years. The day is in our honor and it's going to give me prestige. I think I might... I should check my knights to see their opinion on me. Their opinion is pretty good, so the prestige is better right now. So waiting for the siege to complete. Pause. The war is at 100%. I can now enforce my demands, which will give me, I seize the territory, which will give me allies, who, it's only me, 100 prestige. You gain 50 devotion. And so on, and I enforce my demands, and he lost the war. And right now, I'm also owning that territory. And as you can see, I'm 7 out of 6 of the holdings that I'm currently having, and the domain limit is 6 because I'm a duke, ledger and stewardship is plus 3, and so on. Some things happen, as you can see, since the game moved pretty fast, like some construction got builded, enemy ally joins the war, fresh converted volatiles I got in County of Buzo, I've gained levy size plus 25%, cool, faction created again, King's Laszlo, sure, siege won, and I've taken this guy as a prisoner, which is basically the king, I mean, he escaped, I think, or I got him out. Anyway, let's move faster. This video is so long. Jesus Christ, sorry guys. Hopefully you are going to learn something. Now, it might be a little bit confusing right now because I've just configured and you don't know all the things yet, but let's speak about this, where you can see the realm. You have your vassals on how much they contribute and so on. And you can see their happiness and so on. This is the domain that I'm currently owning myself, what's building up and how much gold I'm getting for each of the domain. The succession laws right now, this guy is going to inherit when he's going to die, but then from the realm's partition, I will lose 3 titles, which will go to Count Poponel of Buzo, which is also my son. So it's fine because it's still in my dynasty, but I need to be sure that I'm going to hold on a lot of things. Military right now, levies are basically the army, you know, the peasants. Hey guys, I need you to war. They grab a fork, they grab and so on, and I'm getting people to form army. Then you have men at arms, which is army that you can hire up, and it's going to cost some monthly prestige, some monthly costs as money, and when you rise them up like I did right now to attack, right now my army is down, is not risen, right? It's they are doing their own things, farming the land and so on. But when I'm calling everybody up to fight, it's going to cost a bit some gold per month. A new thing in Crusader Kings 3, and I love this concept, is the knights. The knights are basically guys at your court that you can bring up. You can recruit them. If, for example, I can have an event where I'm invited knights, which I can't do right now for 2 more years because I've just done it. And basically, there will be people who will come to your court and you will be able to recruit them. And what you want in a knight, like, for example, this guy is right now over here. He has his own perk skills and so on. He has prowess of 24. And those guys right now, I'm allowed to have 8 out of 8 knights. You can write this number up to various events, skill trees and so on, martial skill, and I think you can those are guys who are actually coming with the army, with those, with the levies, with the arm, with the men at arms, and they are on the field actually chopping people, and they are knights like in the true sense, as they have damage and they do a lot more damage based on also on their prowess skills. For example, each point of prowess gives a knight a damage 100 and toughness 10. So for example, this guy has damage 2400 and toughness 240. So this guy is pretty badass, and those guys, I can't really, because we haven't fought in the battlefield, I can't really show you how they look, but those guys do a lot of damage to the enemy team, right? Which is important. Knights effectiveness 175%, because I'm also having the chivalric dominance, because let's actually go over here. As you can see, I've started on this side and I've gained avaricious, which is not that's great, but then I decided to move to the marshal and get some points into those natural dread. Growth control plus 0.3, increase controlling in county progress percent, and then I'm going a little bit on the knight effectiveness, and for example King's Guard is going to allow me to have plus 4 more knights, and the reason for that is that I'm planning to gather more territory and I want to be sure that I'm having some army to do that, right? And control, in case you don't know what it is, and probably you don't, it's when you select a territory like this, you have control. I have absolute control in this territory, but in this territory, because I just gained it, I only have 60% because I just occupied that territory. And for me, in order to lower that control, it's going to do it some a little bit naturally, to time, but there is a guy that in the council that can do that, and I will speak that in a second. You can also hire mercenaries over here. That's army that you are going to pay up front this number, and they will be with you for something like 3 years, I believe, as you can see here. But anyway, I don't have money to do that now, and I don't need a bigger army for three years. But if I am going to try to gain my independence over Hungary, which is very powerful right now, I might want to hold money later and do that later, planning ahead. Right now, some of the things that's very, very, very important, it's the council. This is kind of what you want to do at the beginning, and you want to check out everyone. So the first spot over here is your wife, basically. And this is something cool that they've done in Crusader Kings 3. You can see Crusader King 2, it wasn't clear, but basically the ruler gets some more points based on the stats that your wife has, your spouse, right? As you can see, I've gained +1 diplomacy, +1 martial, +3 stewardship, and so on, because of the skills that my wife has. And you can see she has a lot of stewardship, which means that when she's assisting me, she's giving me more points in stewardship because her stewardship skill is up, right? But then I can tell her right now to help me more with managing my domain, and I'm going to do that now with the idea that I'm gaining 8 more stewardship. And when I unpause, you see my domain up went to 7 out of 7, and I don't need to give this thing to someone else. I will want to do it right now, but both my sons already have territory, and I don't want to give them more right now if I can manage it right now, right? Anyway, then one thing that changed is the bishop, and the bishop is a person that I can't fire, because he's a religion's figure and he's put there automatically. And one thing that you want to do is you want to have this guy with positive attitude toward you. He wants him to be happy right now. As you can see, it's only +5. It's still good, it's on the positive, but as you can see, my realm priest endorses you, which means that I'm getting some gold and some levies from him himself, which is why it's important. Another thing that changed, and all those council members can be sent to do different events. You can just mouse over and it's going to tell you more about what they can do. For example, this guy, one important thing that changed, it used to be in Crusader Kings, it used to be on your counselor. Right now, the fabricate claim falls under the bishop. So right now the bishop is busy for 22 years. I'm trying to convert the faith of the country or of the county. As you can see, if I'm going to the culture is Vlach. This culture is Vlach. This is Hungarian. This is Magyar. But if I'm clicking faiths, this territory is Slovak, Skians, and so on. And this territory is Tengri. This is and so on. So a lot of Catholicism, but those territories are a little bit like this. Some Catholicism, some of something else, because they have been under different type of influences right now, right? And what I'm doing right now with this, I'm trying to rise the faith to Catholicism. So the more things are not in my culture and not in my religious faith, right, the more less control I will have, and I want to have as much control as possible, which means more levies, more less problems, right? So the counselor, it's basically you can put him to gain prestige and make other people who are not around me like me more. It's not that great, to be honest. Then you can put domestic affairs. You can put people close to you to help you. And you can see possible side effects. This is the number that you want to see. See, if I'm clicking this guy has a rating of 14. Diplomacy of 14. This is the counselor. Main skill is diplomacy, right? You want a guy who has a high number here. If you have guys who have low numbers, bad things can happen. Really bad things can happen. Like negative effects, you get negative traits. For example, if you have a low stewardship guy, he can lose money and stuff like that. But if you have a guy with high stewardship skill, possible side effects, for example, this guy, this is my son, this is my new heir, it's having 27 27. This guy skills are insane. Why? Because he's a genius. His wife is also a genius, and she's pregnant, which means that her child, which is going to be part of my dynasty, is going to probably be a genius. So this is going great. Anyway, right now he's been setting up to rise control on the country. County, for example, each of those things also has control development, right? Sorry, not control development. More development means more money, and you want to kind of keep the development high in general at some points. Anyway, this is a bit too complex right now. But for example, if you have low control, you can set up your marshal to do this increased control in county, and right now he's in the county of Buzel. He's over here because this area has control of 24, which is pretty low. I'm also minus 25 popular opinion, and so on and so on. Now, one thing that I want to speak about the territory. When you select this county of Temes, right, you can see there are three holdings. This is Temesvar, which is your castle holding, which is mine. I own this, and I'm having these those things built up there, which giving me, for example, I having walls and towers. I cannot upgrade it because I'm also missing some money, and I'm already doing a construction, but also my culture doesn't have the battlement innovation, so I can't upgrade it yet. Later maybe. Also county of Lugoj is a city, and then also other stuff here. But let's go on Cryo. This territory, as you can see, has Dragășani, which is has no holding, where I will be able to construct a castle, a city, and a temple. If I have the money, and if I have, for example, I will be able to do this when I will get more gold, because the Vlach culture has the city planning innovation. Again, this territory is part of the Vlach culture. Probably we are having this too, I'm not sure. Anyway, just to keep this in mind, this is part of your management of the territory that you have, of the baronies and so on. For example, I can construct a lot of buildings here. You might want to go on pastoral lands, which is going to give you 50 levies and plus 0.2 per month gold, which you will be like, yeah, but this is a few. Yeah, but it adds up. And later you will be able to upgrade it, and you can click the preview to see what are the future improvements going to give you, right? Again, planning for ahead. So I've speak about the military, about the council, which is very important. Again, people with high skills, and what you can look at what they are doing over here. For example, the spy master is disrupting schemes right now. You might be, what are schemes? Okay, let's speak about that right now. If you go on intrigue, you will be able to do hostile schemes, personal schemes, discovered schemes. I also have hooks and secrets. Let's speak a bit about hooks and secrets. This is a new thing in Crusader Kings stream. A hook is kind of like a favor. When you know secrets about other people, like for example, this guy is a non-believer, I can blackmail him for a hook, and then later when I'm taking decisions, like maybe I want to assassinate someone, I can call up other people to help me with the assassination, but based on their relationship with me and their own interest, they might not help me. But if I have a hook on them, and it'll be like, hey, if you don't help me, I'm going to tell a secret that you're a deviant, or that you are a whatnot, or you have a murder scheme. What do I have any kind of... I don't even have any secrets. If I, for example, would have executed someone, like I would have plotted for a king to kill... Let's do something. I tried to do nasty stuff with the king of Hungary, and as you can see, he hates me a lot. He's also my rival. I can't murder him anymore because I've kind of... try to do stuff with him, for him, I mean to him. Let's look at this territory, this guy. I can't declare war. Let's try to murder this guy. It's going to be 40% chance of successful, 55% chance of this thing being discovered. If plot like this get discovered, a scheme like this gets discovered, it's going to be nasty stuff is going to happen. It's going to might take around 4 years based on some stuff. Same thing when I want to sway people. Let's actually look at the realm, and let's see who doesn't like me. This is a courtier. It's kind of, he's not that important, but let's try to do it. Sway, it's going to 95%, 16 months. If I'm going to start to sway the scheme and clicking here, I'm personal scheme, I'm swaying this guy, right? And you can do other stuff, and you can send, again, you can send your your spy master to find up secrets. You click this thingy, you click where you want to send him, and he's going to try to find up secrets. As you can see, he's going in 5 months, he's going to succeed or fail. Another thing that's important, it's the court. You are going to see guests. They are important. There is even some a tree in the focus tree lifestyle, right? That's going to give you more higher quality guests. And for example, she's a guest. She will leave soon, but the game is suggesting that she's a competent schemer. She has intrigue of 12. I might want to get her, because if this guy is going to die, which is having 17 intrigue, the next guy that I'm going to appoint, I don't really have that many good people, or maybe they are busy. Like, for example, Count Pet is also my steward. I don't want to put him, so I will try to recruit them. When I'm going to recruit someone to my court, I don't have a hook on her to force her to join me. It's going to cost me 10 gold, and I'm going to recruit her to the court, and now she's now part of my court, and I can use her for whatever. By the way, one thing to mention, females can be spy masters, but they cannot be other things, at least in the current religion and the current type of laws that I'm currently having, right? What else? Factions. People are kind of preparing, the peasants are preparing to ramble because of the low control, and I will have to deal with them soon yet again. But something that's very important is the decisions. If you don't know exactly what to do with the game in general, those are long-term goals that are going to, the game gives to you. So for example, strengthen the broadline. I'm trying to check up as many things here to do them, and so on. Other short-term decisions are basically those. I can search for a physician, which is going to give me 2 guys that I can hire, but right now I'm having a physician, this guy. A physician is a doctor. It's important for him to have a high learning skill, by the way. As you can see, Color Hunt is going to give this much, is going to less... it's going to give me less stress, and it's going to give me opportunities to increase prestige. Hold the feast, I can't do it. Again, this is the things that are going to happen. It's going to cost this much gold. One thing that you want to do at the beginning is maybe host a feast and or go to a pilgrimage and then host a feast. The going on the pilgrimage only happens every 15 years, and it's going to cost gold, and you will basically travel to a location like Jerusalem, Vatican, and one other. And it will allow you to... Some events are going to happen when you travel, and it's going to allow you to gain prestige and piety, most likely. And then when you are going to come back, you're going to gain a lot of piety, and you're going to get this trait of pilgrim. So it's also something that you want to do from the beginning. And those are decisions, are stuff that you want to check constantly, right? Now, let's try to... I'm going to go back to the menu. We are kind of approaching the end of this really long video. I wanted to do it faster, but the game has a lot of systems and so on. Let's actually start with the Irish guy, the tutorial island, which the game suggests for you to start with, right? You just started the game. People told you, myself included, hey, start with this guy. Right, the petty kingdom of Mordshad. What are the things that you want to do? It's like, oh, what to do now? I watched Pat's video, my video. Thank you for watching and clicking like. What am I going to do now? So, some of the first things that you want to do. The game will also give you some tips if you are new. But he will tell you some stuff here. Those are with red because they are important. I have no lifestyle chosen. My heir, this guy, because I have a son, but I'm not currently married. Probably because the spouse died or something, whatever. It's not there, but doesn't matter. And I'm also not married. I'm pretty young. I can still marry and make more babies. My son is 18. He also needs to marry as fast as possible. Because if we are to look at the dynasty tree... So you can see, as you can see, we have more people around. We want to keep things going, and since this guy is closely related to me, I can control them better, and we want to get as many babies as possible, right? 59 members and 15 living. It's a pretty big family. Now, one new important thing in Crusader Kings 3 is this suggestion, the issues that's up there. And he's telling me, I can declare war, not endorsed by my bishop, and if I'm clicking this, as you can see, my bishop hates me. I can also see this at here. This is my bishop, he hates me and he's not endorsing me, meaning that I don't get anything, right? Family members can get married. It's telling you also stuff around you, and I can also declare wars. So, always check this, always check the things on top. But, ruler, let's start with my ruler. I need a woman, a wife, sorry, so I can start producing babies. What do you want to marry? One thing that I'm doing early on sometimes, you usually want to marry someone who has a good rank. So, for example, let's try this one. It's going to don't give me any prestige because we are kind of like at the same level, but she will gain prestige. Doesn't matter. But one thing that I'm trying to do early on is I'm going to click filters and I'm going to click traits and I'm going to click inheritable. So I'm only seeing characters with traits like quick, for example, like pretty, that are inheritable. Also fertile and so on. There are other filters that you can apply. And then I'm looking at also sorting them by alliance power. So for example, I can marry her. I'm not going to lose prestige, so that's good. And it will allow me to have someone who has a trait that can be inherited by our future children, right? And she's also a potential alliance with County of Vistia. I'm not sure where this is. I can click it to go there. It's pretty far away, so alliance with that part is not going to help me at all. Usually, when you marry your children and so on, you want to marry people who in high power, people around, because when the person who married died, and the title will get that it, the title can get inherited to you, basically something like that, right? So let's look at the I might marry her because she's pretty. She also has a high number of stewardship, but if I'm marrying, she's a lowborn. Oh, I'm also not losing prestige, which is good. If I was a king right now or something like that, I will lose a lot of prestige for marrying her because she's a nobody. So let's actually go on what would I need as a wife. Doesn't matter that much. I'm mostly looking at the traits. But normally you want to also look at the skills because the wife skills are going to help you also. I don't need stewardship because the holdings, it's okay right now. Diplomacy maybe. But let's look mostly at powerful traits because those traits come in various levels. Like quick is only one, but then what intelligent, which is plus 3 activity, and then is genius, which is plus 5. The icon right now is only one candle. Let's see if we find something with two candles. Probably not because it's early in the game. But for example, we have this. This is a small flower. It's comely. It's only diplomacy plus 1 and fertility plus 10. But this is pretty, which is or handsome, right? Plus 2 diplomacy, plus 2 or 24% fertility. But this is beautiful. It's plus 3 diplomacy, plus 30 fertility, and so on. So we might want to do that, for example. So let's actually select, it doesn't matter right now, but let's actually select someone. I want beautiful to get this thing going. She will get a lot of prestige because she's marrying a petty king, but whatever. We are going to send a proposal and that will happen. Let's also marry up my son, arrange a marriage. Okay, or I think he's going to marry himself because he's not in my court. I'm not sure yet. See, intelligent. We want people with... That's a very good trait. I've seen a video from a guy who tried to, and he succeeded, to have giants and, I believe, geniuses. And were having a huge amount of stats. So... let's go with her, whatever. Why you want to change to look at chance for children and it's medium, that's fine. You might also want to try out not to marry gay characters, because you can see this guy is heterosexual, but they are bisexual and you know, gay. Then what do you want to do? You want to look at the stats that you have, based on that you can plan different things. You want to look at the traits that you have, again, to plan up for things. And you want to select your focus tree, and because I'm on the martial experience, I will get more experience there. And oh, this guy, it's random. The stats are sometimes random, and the trees that are already completed are in general also random, which again brings up to the replayability. So in this case, I'm not sure what I would want. Maybe the chivalry focus, because of the attraction, or the authority focus, but I don't have that much territory yet, so it doesn't matter that much. But let's pick up this. And I'm going to start getting, I'm already having those advantages, and I will start to get experience by in martial, and in some time I will have a new point that I'm going to be able to put anywhere, and I'm probably going to put it on overseas just to get the trade, which is going to give me martial stewardship and growth factor control plus 50% per month. Only that you want to look it's at the council to see what people you have. This guy is only rating of 10. Rating of 10 is average. I would like something better than this, and I do have this guy. This guy is a powerful vassal, and he will demand a seat at the council, but I will deal with him later, because I will prefer someone who has better diplomacy, because he won't fail as much. As you can see, this guy is going to get upset. Let's see, plus 10, and when I'm going to fire him, minus 61. So I will have to sway him, so he doesn't cause problems later. Let's look then at the steward. This guy is better, not that better. This guy is also powerful. I will leave that guy, because I don't want to upset him. And then this guy is the same, and then this guy is okay right now. Right then, you want to put them to do missions that are useful to you, and so on. And then you want to look at the territory that you are currently having. This is my main thingy. I don't have I'm going to hold my money, because the money are going to be slowly building up. As you can see, I'm only getting 2.5 per month. But one thing that I want to do at some point, I want to build walls and towers in, you know, kind of like a castle, in order to have a castle in case I'm going to get attacked and so on. I know, maybe it's not ideal, but it's something that I'm usually doing and so on. So one thing that, as you can see, the game suggested a couple of things. One thing that we can do right now, if I remember correctly, we can declare war on this guy, mostly because we have a de jure claim on Earl of Desmond on this whole territory. As you can see, his army is inferior. He has no ally. We are also not having an ally. His army is not too that inferior, so he might be lucky with it, but normally we maybe should try to get an alliance with someone, or of our neighbors, like for example Mary or son with someone from the neighborhood or something like that. But for the fun of it, let's just declare war to this guy. I can't. Oh, no Casus Belli choices. Okay, this is the Casus Belli. Those are the demands that I want. This is the current objective that I want. Earldom of Desmond. It's going to cost me prestige, which I currently have, and I'm going to declare war. We are now at war. And I'm going to click this button to rise all the armies. I'm going to wait a little bit for the armies to join. As you can see, not that huge of a difference. I'm told my army to move where his army is, and it's the game is telling me that we have a potential battle in 20 days and I will probably win. Why? Because he is defending in wetlands. I guess that's good for him. He has defensive buildings, but I have a better army commander and I have more soldiers, and the army commander is actually me, and that's good. But another thing that I should have done is to check out the military and see the knights that I'm having. The knights are not the best, only 15. I should have maybe try to invite some knights and maybe get a better one and so on, but for the fun of it, let's just go and look at how a battle report will look. The approval for the marriage was accepted, and for my son and for myself, and right now I have a wife, as you can see, and now the wife is going to help me manage the realm. She appears over here, assists the ruler, and very, very soon the fighting will start. I'm going to pause, I'm going to click this because I want to watch what's happening here. The game is going to, every day I believe, or every month or something like that, the game is going to roll a random number and that guy is going to have an advantage. Right now the advantage is 9 in my favor. As you can see, I have elite quality of the army, this guy has superior quality. I have 6 knights, he has 5 knights. And let's see what's going to happen. The defender has 4 and common plus 7 in my favor. It's getting in my favor. His army is going down. I will probably win. This is an event that happened during the battle. As you can see, my brother Konjabar has been wounded and the injury runs deep. I fear that his body is not strong enough to fight for his own and the death is dying by his side. Don't worry, by the way, the game is paused. There's nothing to be done. And this guy, he is my half-brother, which is sad because he's part of my house. He has children, however, so at least that's... He's also have a bad congenital trait, so the fact that he dies is not that bad. Okay. And... I've won that battle. The army is running away. I've only gained plus 20% on the war score. And let's look at the details on the screen. I've lost 54 men. He lost 101. He still has an army of 152 survivors. He's running away right now. I've gained some fame. I gained some war score. And as you can see, the knights have done 65 kills. You know when I've said that the knights are pretty good? So yeah, those 6 guys did 65 kills. I'm going to dismiss this. And right now I've started to siege, which is not really happening right now because I don't have enough soldiers. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, the army garrison is 350. I need some reinforcements. I've lost some army, which is that reason. So I'm going to click the council, and this guy is right now organizing levies, which means that levy size, garrison size, and reinforcement rate is plus 20%. Which is good, which means that reinforcement rate is what matters right now. Yeah, I don't want this. So his play is correct. If I am to check the army right now, it should tell me I have attrition and I have... okay, it's interesting thingy. So yeah, maybe I should have planned it better, you know. But anyway, this video has been long enough. I think you kind of got a good idea what you want to do when you start the game. Look at the issues on the UI. The game is telling you some stuff to do. Look at your ruler. Get a wife, make babies. Start making babies ASAP. Look at your heir, your sons, if you have. Marry them so they can start making babies. Try to get good congenital traits in your family. Look at your stats, look at your traits, pick up a focus tree, doesn't matter which one at first, try to look at experiment and so on. Then look at the council, get the best people you can in the council, put them up to do missions. Then look at the territory that you own and then try to set up kind of like a goal to you. Try to get some more territory from around you. Look at the duchy, the county that you have, the titles that you have. If you don't have title, if you can't declare war right now, something that I might do right now, I might look at, for example, this guy. This guy has this title, and he has some army, more than me. Let's see, this guy has less army than me. He has this territory. I might just send my bishop to fabricate a claim on this thing. It's going to take 12 months. And it's going to, at the end of the 12 months, I will get an event. It's going to cost me something like 80 gold. And I'm going, if I'm accepting that, I will get a claim on that county, on that title, basically. The Earldom of Arnhul. and I would be able to declare war on that and then get that territory. But then again, select, look at the person, who that person has alliances to. He has no alliances. He has this amount of soldier, which is a bit more than me. But if I'm able to conquer this, if I'm able to maybe look more into my territory on how I can rise the total number of soldiers, maybe when I will get money later, I will be able to get something that has more levies. For example, if I'm building an outpost, I will get 50 more levies. If I'm getting for the military camps, I'm going to get 100 more levies, and so on. So again, plan for ahead, try to reproduce, and so on and so on. So anyway, thank you guys for watching this. I hope you enjoyed it. See you soon, I guess, and goodbye.